back to the lactate thing. Very interesting. Yeah. So read up on this. You know, George Brooks, a friend of mine, he's working now with some other physicians at UCLA looking at the effects of actually exogenous lactate on helping treat TBI, because TBI...
But why not just exogenous BHB?
Or that, exactly.
I mean, have you seen what Dom D'Agostino's done?
I think I've read one of his studies on cancer. I think it was cancer.
You should see Dom's work in TBI.
That's how
he got started. He's a neurobiologist.
Oh, okay.
The only reason he's in cancer now is because he started out working in neurobiology.
Interesting.
And using TBI models.
I didn't know that. But it's the same thing. Lactate, beta-hydroxybutyrate, it doesn't matter.
They're completely overcoming trauma.
Doing similar things. They're both thermodynamically favorable. They allow glucose sparing. They allow glucose to then be, you know, used to make glutathione, which is important in the brain when you have damage. But what's interesting is that TBI also disrupts astrocytes' ability to make lactate. And what I'm wondering when you were talking about those two might just synergize.
I think the trauma causes an oxidative stress. So I think what's happening is pyruvate dehydrogenase is getting interrupted, and all of a sudden you're having a transient but violent interruption of energy to the brain.
Yes.
This is obviously of high interest to the military because of blast injuries. And Dom would know this, so it's absolutely worth talking about this with him. I'm sure the DOD is all over this. I hope the DOD is all over this. Because the interesting question is, do you have to have the BHB or the lactate in your system at the time of injury to prevent it? Or can administration be done immediately following the trauma?
Or is there a kinetics? Is there a certain time? I think because of the fact that it allows glucose sparing, which if you have a trauma is... And this has been shown in animal models for TBI, that if you can prevent this was done by putting glutathione transcranially, which obviously is not going to happen in humans. But anyways, they could prevent like over 50% of the damage because they were able to sequester the reactive oxygen species that start to cause all the damage and the inflammatory pathways that start to get out of control. So I think that if you allow that glucose to be used for the pentose phosphate pathway within a certain time frame, I don't know what that time frame is. I think it was something within a couple of hours. Then, independent of the allowing your neurons to get this easier source of energy, if your neurons are using glucose because they need energy, but the glucose that can't be used to repair that damage through the pentose phosphate pathway, I think that's one component of it in terms of the temporal effects, like how soon after the damage.